He's an actor on the big and small screens, best known for his roles in Star Trek, The Big Bang Theory, and of course, Stand By Me.
Is it loaded?
Hell no. What do you think I am?
Jesus!
Let's get out of here! Come on!
Gordy did it! Gordy, let's get it!
Who's letting cherry bombs off out here?
Oh, man, you should have seen your face. Damn, that was cool. That was really fine.
You knew it was loaded, you wet end. I'm gonna be in trouble now. That Tupper babe saw me.
Shit, Gordy, she thought it was firecrackers.
I don't care. That was a mean trick, Chris.
Hey, Gordy. I didn't know it was loaded. Honest.
But now to self-confessed nerd, Will Wheaton, also add author to his resume. His brand new memoir, Still Just a Geek, explores fame, love, trauma, tragedy, and everything in between. And he joins us now from Los Angeles. Will, thanks so much for your time this morning. It's blown my mind I'm getting the chance to speak to you. You've had a career that spans...
it's such an honor.
Oh, thank you. You've got a career that spans more than 30 years. So this is going to be quite some memoir.
Yeah, the first half of Still Just a Geek is the 2004 memoir I wrote, which was a collection of blog posts from willwheaton.net that came together to tell a story of my journey from person who kind of used to be a Star Trek actor and not much else as far as I was concerned in my identification, to being a writer and a husband and a father, and growing into kind of being an adult and taking control of my life. The second half of Still Just a Geek is a lot of notable essays about living with mental illness, about raising my kids, working on the Big Bang Theory, being part of Star Trek, and those aspects of my life.
Wow. So what is it like for you to revisit these stories? And what are you hoping that people will gain from that?
It was an interesting experience. I went through a ton of emotions as I did it. I was a very different person in 2004 than I am now. I was living with undiagnosed depression and anxiety and post-traumatic stress disorder. And that pain really expresses itself a lot in my writing. And when I was working on Still Just a Geek and annotating what I had written in 2004, I spent a fair amount of meaningful emotional time with the person I was when I wrote that and did a ton of therapy, healing work as I wrote those annotations and really revisited what was going on that I wasn't really talking about when I wrote that original book.
Yeah, I remember I've done a lot of reading on you, obviously, because I've been looking forward to this as well, this annotated memoir. If I can take you back to the 80s, when you gained that widespread attention as a child actor for your work in Stand By Me, Gordy LaChance, what impact did that role have on your career?
I mean, it fundamentally changed everything about my life. I was a kid who didn't want to be an actor. It's something that I was pushed into. And I'm really lucky that I happened to be the right person for that role in Stand By Me. All of us were young actors who were very much those characters. We were given the opportunity to just embody them. And Rob put together a really beautiful movie that let those things that made us uniquely suited for those characters really shine through. And audiences reacted to it in a way that directly led to me being cast on Star Trek. That led directly to me being cast on The Big Bang Theory. And that part of my story has led to me talking to you today.
Yeah, which is fantastic. How did that role, obviously it impacted your career, but I've heard about Jerry O'Connell, how he spoke about your experience then, and he wished he just asked how you were. We've talked to Corey Feldman on the show as well. How did because essentially you were living Gordy's life, which paralleled your own, how did that impact? Yeah. Was it a positive thing that you'd done this movie, or a negative thing? I mean, do you feel as though you needed that movie at the time as well?
I turned 13 during production, and I wasn't aware of any of that. I said this to Jerry when he mentioned it on the talk. We were kids. We didn't know. And I really appreciate that he was so willing to extend a hand to me at that time. And I know that if I had known how to ask for it, he absolutely would have been there for me. River would have been there for me, too. And because I just didn't know what was going on in my life, I didn't appreciate what it meant to take my experience as this child who was scapegoated at home, who was aggressively unloved by my father, and put into a role where the character had exactly those same things in common with me. I was just a kid. I didn't know what all of that meant. And as I have grown older, I have come to really love and cherish and appreciate Stand By Me. And I want to be very clear about something. I did not have a good life at home. I wasn't happy. I didn't feel safe. When I was on the set, and especially when I was on location in Oregon working on Stand By Me, I was happy the entire time. I felt safe. I felt at home. Rob made me feel loved and supported and worthy in ways that the man who was my father worked really hard to not allow me to feel. So being on the set for Stand By Me was absolutely wonderful. And Star Trek was the same thing too. Being on the set was a real safe place, surrounded by adults and father figures and mother figures who really loved me and genuinely cared about me and became the family that I just didn't have. And it was a wonderful blessing. I was never comfortable with any of the attention. I didn't like all of the teen idol stuff. That was weird and way outside of my comfort zone. I have come to be really okay with it because I meet a lot of men and women now who had crushes on Wesley, and then as an extension had crushes on me. So I was kind of like in their school lockers and things like that. That is a wonderful thing for me now as an almost 50-year-old man to like be part of that part of people's stories. I just love it. I think it's really cool. But at the time, it was really hard. It was a lot of attention that made me feel even more weird and awkward than I already was.
Yeah, well, and there's a lot of kids who feel weird and awkward about their own scenarios in different situations. Being a self-confessed nerd, you've spoken publicly about the challenges you faced as a kid regarding to bullying. Your stories are certainly going to help other people. What advice do you have for people experiencing something similar when it comes to bullying?
The thing that a bully wants is to make the target feel weak and controlled and afraid. And I have found that one of the most effective ways of dealing with a bully is to do some version of this. You effectively look them right in the eye and you say to the bully, I see exactly what you're trying to do. I understand what you're trying to do. And what you're trying to do takes at least two people. I will not be one of those people. And I walk away. It is real easy for me to say that as a 50-year-old man who is a father and a husband, who is real insulated from like the social crucible of what we in America called high school. I don't know what you call it in Australia. I don't know if it's the same name. But when you're a teenager and you're in school, it's unbelievably hard. The thing we have to remember about bullies, every single bully is carrying forward generational trauma that was imposed on them by someone else in their life. And it is up to us to break that cycle. When we are bullied and we survive it, we have an opportunity and I think kind of a responsibility to not create another generation of bullies with our own children. And those of us who are adults now who have survived it, I believe we also have an obligation to stand up for marginalized people and bullied people and people who are treated as a capital O other by the capital E establishment. I think it's real important that we all stand up for them and let everyone know that we see you when you're a bully. We see how weak and afraid you are, and that all you know how to do is hurt and destroy things. That to me is really tragic and really sad. And I think that when we approach bullying from that point of view, this is tragic and sad, but also this is my boundary, dude, and you're not coming past it. To not react, to not give the bully the reaction they want is different from just walking away, which is what my generation was taught. We can absolutely say, this isn't okay. I will not participate in this, and now I am walking away. Or I see what you're doing to this person, and I'm just going to be a human here that gets in between the two of you. And this now you deal with me instead of the person that you're targeting. Okay, now that I have your attention, I'm just going to take it all away from you.
Oh, very well said.
It's that simple and that complicated.
Well, it is, but people need to hear it. They really do. So tell us, we have dabbled in almost everything. What is next for Will Wheaton?
I'm working on a couple of different books right now, and a short story that I pitched that the editor loves, that we have to get permission from an important person before I can actually write. Those are the really big, really exciting things that are kind of like just on the other side of my personal event horizon. In the moment, I am having just the time of my life talking about Still Just a Geek. I became a New York Times bestselling author last week, and that is just one of the coolest things in the world. I cannot believe that has happened to me in my life. It's so fun. And I'm just doing my very, very best to really enjoy it without letting it become like a thing that I would miss if it were taken away from me. Yeah. I don't know if that makes sense. It makes sense in my head.
It makes complete sense. I was a huge fan of yours. I'm even bigger now. I can't wait to see what you do next. Will Wheaton's...
Oh, you're so kind.
Of course. Your memoir, Still Just a Geek, is available for purchase right now. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. It really has been my pleasure.
Such a pleasure talking to you. Have a wonderful tomorrow.
That's it. Yeah. The next few hours are great. Enjoy them. Take care and thank you.